Hello friends, this video on chemical coordination and integration part 1 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. Topics to be covered in this lesson are endocrine glands and hormones, human endocrine system, hormones of heart, kidney and gastrointestinal tract, mechanism of hormone action. So again, we will start from the same topic. What is control and coordination? Because in this lesson, we are going to talk about the chemical coordination. So how the synchronization or the coordination inside our body takes place with the help of chemicals. So that is what we will see here. Now, before that, let us quickly review what we spoke about control and coordination. What it is? It is nothing but the synchronization between the different organs of the body so that they can work together in harmony to perform the vital activities of life. Of course, so whenever the word coordination comes, you can remember of a group dance where a number of people are dancing and their footsteps, their hand movements, everything is in synchronization with each other. So that is how the different organs or the different parts of our body function. So all the organs are in sync with each other. For example, when you see something really scary, for example, if you see a big lion in front of you, what do? You immediately start running. So that means your eyes helped you in seeing the lion, your brain helped you to interpret how dangerous the lion is, and then your muscles helped you to run. So that way is your eyes, brain, muscles, so they are all different parts of your body and they all together helped you to run. Right? So this entire synchronization is control and coordination. Now, as we have spoken about this in previous lesson also, I told you that there are two ways in which this synchronization is taken care of in human body. One is with the help of the nervous tissue, that is the nervous system, where there are nerves which have the special ability to get excited, and then they carry electric impulses from one part of the body to another. So that is one way of handling the scenario. There is another way to manage the synchronization, and that is with the help of chemicals. So now in this lesson, we are going to talk about that chemical control and coordination part. So now when you look at examples, like when you hit a football, so all your muscle movements, whether your hands, your legs, your foot, so everything has to be synchronized. Even your eyes, you just cannot close your eyes and play football, right? Because you need to see where the ball is going, how should you hit the ball. So it needs a proper synchronization. Or similarly, when you get an electric shock, you immediately jump off, right? So that instant reaction again is because of controlled coordination. And in previous lesson, we spoke about this instant responses. We spoke about the reflex action, which happens due to the presence of the central nervous system. So now here we will not talk about the instant responses because they are mostly due to the central nervous system. Rather, we will talk about those changes or those coordination which takes place inside our body and which arises or which happens due to some specific chemicals inside our body. Now, before we start talking about those chemicals, what do they do, how are they produced, etc., we should first know that why do we need an endocrine system. So this entire system where the coordination is taken care by chemicals which are known as hormones, this entire system is known as the endocrine system. But before we actually start talking about the endocrine system in detail, we should know why do we need a separate endocrine system when we already have a nervous system in place to take care of control and coordination. So let us have a quick look at the advantages and disadvantages of both nervous system and endocrine system. So now let us see how this coordination takes place in different life forms. However, here we are going to talk about animals, that is specifically about human beings. So let us focus on animals. So one way is, as I said, is the nervous system. And we have already discussed about this nervous system in detail. So you all know what it is by now. So what happens in this system? There are specific tissues, I mean not specific tissues, I should say that the cells of the nervous system, that is the nervous tissue, they are all made up of the nerve cells called neurons, and those neurons have this speciality that they get excited. They are excitable cells, that is they can recognize any external changes in the environment, which they call as stimulus, and then they can generate electric impulses which they can carry from one nerve cell to another. So the neurons can actually conduct electric impulses, and by this way of electric impulse transmission, it gets conveyed very fast. So it is a very faster way of transmission. So faster transmission happens here. So you get an instant response, so you get quick response to the stimulus. For example, when you touch a hot mug of coffee, you immediately remove your hand. So that instant response comes because the conduction is also very fast. Because if the nerve cells take a long time to carry the information from your fingertip to the central nervous system, then obviously you are not going to get a quick response. So it is a faster way of transmission. However, there are many limitations attached to it. So one of them is it can reach only the cells which are connected by nervous tissue. Now, as I said, this speciality of being getting excited or being capable of recognizing a stimulus, this is only limited to the nerve cells. That is, only the neurons can do that. Not all cells of our body can do that, because the nerve cells have got specialized detectors to detect the impulse. Now, it is very good that they have this speciality, but at the same time, since all the cells of the body do not have this speciality, so a major limitation comes into picture. That is, these electric impulse conduction can happen only till those areas where nervous tissues are present. Wherever nerve cells are not present, these impulses cannot reach there. So that means this nervous system can carry information from one part of the body to another, but it cannot reach all parts of the body. It cannot reach all the cells of the body. So if you want to make some changes at the cellular level, if you want some change to take place in all the cells of your body, that is not going to happen by nervous system, because it will not be able to reach each and every cell of the body. Okay, so that is one limitation. The next is electric impulses cannot be continuously created and transmitted. Now, in our previous lesson, I already spoke about how the electric impulse gets generated, and then how it gets conducted along a neuron, and then how it is transmitted across various neurons. So we spoke about that process, and everything happens due to a difference of the potential gradient, due to the polarization, depolarization, again repolarization. As a result of all those changes, this entire process of electric impulse generation and conduction take place. So from that, we saw that once the impulse gets generated, then it gets transmitted. Now the cell would need some time to reset its mechanism to generate a new impulse. It is not that the cell is continuously generating an impulse. It is something like one impulse gets generated and then that impulse gets conducted. Again, there is a time lag before another impulse gets generated. So that means a time lag will always be involved, right? So the impulses cannot be continuously generated. And when we talk about some changes in our body, for example, the best example to consider here is growth. How does growth happen? Growth happens when the cells which are present in our body, they increase in number, either by cell division or when the cells enlarge. That means each cell increase in size. Now this happens throughout our body. It is not that only our hands increase or only our hands grow and our legs don't grow. It is not like that. So everything grow proportionately. Now, this growth is possible because all the cells in our body are undergoing some change. They are all undergoing some growth. So that is possible because this information that, okay, you have to grow, this information is reaching each and every cell of the body. Now, you need somebody who can carry that information to each and every cell of the body. So who will carry that information? So that information is, it cannot be carried by the nervous system, because these impulses, as I said, one thing is they cannot reach all the cells. The second thing is there will always be a time lag. So it is not getting continuously generated. So as far as growth is concerned, all cells need to grow continuously. right? Because it is a gradual process which happens for years together. So these are the two limitations of the nervous system which were taken care by the endocrine system, and that is why we have a separate system called the endocrine system. Now what happens in endocrine system? So when I talk about the endocrine system, we are going to talk about the control and coordination using chemicals. So here some chemicals are released by the stimulated cells, and these chemicals diffuse all around. So it is not that the so there is no role of electric impulses. So you do not need specialized cells to carry those impulses. It is just some chemicals which get produced. And who will produce those chemicals? There are some specialized cells in the body who can produce those chemicals. Now, even if those specialized cells are not present everywhere inside the body, that's okay. Even if they are present at certain regions of the body, when they produce those chemicals can diffuse all around the body. So the chemicals can actually reach each and every cell of the body. So one limitation of the nervous system is already covered. Now here, one thing is that since the information will reach from those chemicals which will diffuse taking its own sweet time, so the transmission will obviously be slower. So the transmission here is not going to be as fast as the nervous system. So here it will get transmitted slowly. However, the advantages is that one is it can reach all the cells, because by diffusion these chemicals will reach each and every cell of the body. Next is it is a continuous process. So there is no time lag involved. It is not that you produce the chemicals until and unless the chemicals doesn't reach each and every cell of the body, you cannot release more chemicals. It is not like that. So the chemicals can be continuously released by the stimulated cells, and meanwhile the chemicals which are getting released will keep on diffusing all around the body. So it is a continuous process. There is no time lag involved. Now due to these limitations of the nervous system, the endocrine system came into picture. So now we have to understand what are these stimulated cells. Now when I say the stimulated cells, they are nothing but like how in nervous system you had the excited cells called the neurons. Similarly here also you have some cells which can actually recognize the changes outside and not the changes in the environment. Now when these chemicals diffuse all around the body, they will get detected by some other cells and then they get transmitted. So these chemicals which we are talking about every time, so these chemicals are known as hormones, and this is the most important thing that we are going to talk about in this lesson. So in this lesson we are going to understand what are hormones, how are they produced, what do they do, what are the different types of hormones, who produce hormones. So all these things will be discussed in the next few slides. Thank you. Please visit www.examfear.com to watch more videos, attempt free online test, get free study material, find tutors and mentors. Thank you once again.